De vågar inte komma in där för det var för mycket folk.
Vad säger
De är för blyga för att komma in.
Ja, men det är inte.
Vi pratar med dem, varsin där.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can we
hand the leg? Yes, hand the leg. Unless, only if you ask
questions. Do you submit any questions?
We can ask the questions if you want to.
It should be on the webpage, otherwise.
We can ask if you want.
We're not here.
How is that supposed to work?
We have no idea. I think it's not working. Hello?
So we are at the machine learning part. If I'm not completely wrong, there should be a number of questions. But I'm not wrong. Okay, question one, good working again. Let's say that for the end. Let's look into something more specific first. So that's the Shannon plot, the sequence logo, and the extra problem. Yes. So when to stop? Probably P when you realize it's an interview, complete this entire sequence. In device learning, what's the output of the example? Yes, it's more than the candidates, it's a create kind of unsupervised learning. What is the analysis of all the things? Yeah. Okay, probably okay, fine, one last thing is fine. So I guess it's a torch. Yeah.
How do you
need
to know?
Oh, okay. So the idea basically, what we're talking about today, is how to extract information from a sequence, or from a multiple sequence alignment, that are not necessarily homology based. So how do we learn things about a sequence that is not directly by homology? So already, I mean, this is a classical example, is the active sites of a series of peptides. So I showed you some pictures before that are, if you look at active sites, the three residues that are basically all the same, of the same position, but they are in proteins that are completely unrelated. They have different structure, absolutely no homology, etc. And there are a number of other cases. I mean, you have like the Tata box or the stop codon. I mean, that's information that is in sequence, but it's not homology based. So basically, transcription binding size. It's not that part, but it sort of evolves independently at times. that is what we're so it is important to try to get this information also, because that it tells you about biology. And the original way to do this was probably by using what's called patterns. So people basically look at sequences and try to collect information quite manually. There are automatic methods for the patterns, but they were never really, I would say, adopted in a large amount. It's not the best way to do it. They were never really that popular. But we only had a few examples. You say, if you have this, it should be a pattern base. If you have this signal, it should be something else. So, and you describe these motifs as something like some rules. You have A, then a G, or a C, and then C is one residue, and then T. So that would explain all of these things here. And all the serine active peptides are the proline, alanine, glycine, or serine, something, serine, methionine, something, proline, alanine, threonine, and leucine, and phenylalanine. It's very specific rules that if you have it, you don't have it. And this was the limitation of these things is that and for instance, assume that it's like 99% have serine and 1% have glycine, you should have a much higher weight in the serine. That is more likely to be correct. And maybe there are actually a few that also have an alanine that is 1 in 1,000 that you have to ignore. So that's these very rule based things are not very aren't optimal for finding the rules. I mean, they are sort of being abandoned because they are really, but in the beginning they were very good because they described things. So of course, some other individuals all into the block database, you can extract some things from the same things in the block database. You have, you can see, these all proofs do the same thing, and this is an important motif. So there are these methods like gibbs sampling things that you can extend these. So for instance, if you want to find transcription fiber binding sites, you don't know this exactly where it is, but it knows to be maybe 1,000 bases before a certain gene that's regulated with this transcription factor. So then you try to look for patterns among these 1,000 bases, among a lot of the genes that are regulated with the same transcription factor, and you try to find this is a possible binding site of this thing. So you can continue to do homology, which the alignments are too weak. So there are ways to do it, but it's not, the probabilistic models are much better. Yes?
Clarify what's the pattern and what's
the
motif.
It's the same thing.
Okay.
That's different words. It's called. And the terms use a pattern here. You have the pattern of motif is this, like these rules to do. It's used a profile, as we discussed yesterday. So you can basically have a profile. You have basically the only difference is here you have probability in position. You can have a but it's 90% chance of return, so you can add the things together, so you have much more flexibility. Or, you can also use hidden bottom ones. And all these disadvantages, of course, they're not exact, but they are far more powerful. I mean, it might be slower, depends on how many gaps you allow, I guess, but that's not a big problem. But the good thing is, there is a database for the closed site. So it contains very many of these patterns. Some of these are homology based, some of these are patterns for homologous families. So there are really like other databases of homologous families. But there are also patterns that are really are there for things that are homologous. So you have like patterns for like think fingers that are micro homologous, they are very different. They have all the same motif. They have histidines and cysteines binding zinc. So there are, I mean, I guess, cells up there. It contains 1,300 patterns, only 1,771 entries. So there are a few types things that are can be used for annotating things. You can have phosphorylation sites, trypsin binding sites, trypsin cleavage sites, etc. So it contains a lot of information that is useful for annotating your protein. But most of these are probably made more or less manually. Someone has sat down with the sequence and find these patterns, like which maybe helps some computational tools. So there's a lot of manual information there. Right, as I said, they even have this, these are things that are more homologous information. So if you have this, so this is phosphorylated site in this family, so it means that if you have a pattern, you probably have a phosphorylated site, and this is how the energy is going to look like. So this will go through in the lab, I think, one of these days. Just try to use it, see what you find. So the sequence logos is mainly a very, very useful way to describe sequence signals. And if you want to find this pattern, it's a very useful way. And basically, it's nothing complicated, it's just a way to describe a multi-sequence alignment, basically. Or the amino acid frequencies in each position. So the easy way to have a multi-sequence alignment would be to say, okay, let's have here, and we have a sequence here, and we have maybe only an threonine there, and here we have maybe a lot of different amino acids. If we just write the letters on top of each other, and then you maybe have an isolation here, etc. You could do that. So you have basically write the letters next to each other and then have a size of letters there. However, what's nice to see is that you also vary the total height of this. So in this one, you have high conservation, you have high entropy. So then you have that way, so then the total height here is also dependent on what's called entropy. I come back to that in a second. So then this is that means that you see the big letters here are important because they mean something that are conserved. And you see what I mean, others are there. So basically, entropy is the same type of entropy as we have in physics. We have in the gas phase, if it's squeezed into a small box, you have a lower entropy. If you have it freely between line, you have higher entropy. So it's just if you have the sequence that you have, it's not that the sum of the the sum of the frequencies of each, the sum of the frequency of each letter in the alphabet, in this case, alpha amino acids and nucleotides, and often use log 2. So basically, if everything is completely conserved, this is going to be 1, and what's the log of 1? And what is log of 0? Should we check with our computers? What is log of 0? I don't know it. Yeah, I can't do it. Well, it doesn't matter because you multiply with 0, so that's it. This will be infinite on that. So basically, you have if everything is perfect compiled, you have an entropy of 0. If everything we want, but it's 0 plus 0 plus everything else. So basically, you have 100% frequency of one amino acid, meaning you have an entropy of 0, and this is perfect conserved, you have no variability. So it's like freezing the atoms in the gas, and they don't move. And anything else is going to give some number. So if it's completely random, of course, assuming you're doing 4 letters here, you're going to have 0.25 times log 0.25, 4 times this. Whatever number that would be. Actually, you also use log 2, so this would be actually 1. But so you can do that and just calculate it. So if you only have 2 symbols, so you can have 0% of one and 100% of the other one, or 100% of the first one and 0% of the second one, or something in between. And of course, you have the highest entropy in the middle, which happens to be 1 if you go use log in base 2. And it's 0 at the end.
Sorry, what is P stand for?
The frequency, from probability to amino acid in the distribution. So
that's the P is the same P.
Yeah, as that. Yeah. But it has two symbols, you have A and B, 0 and 1. Simple 1, yeah, simple 1 and simple 2. So, if you would have four symbols, then another would be different, of course, you would have to have four dimensions, but if you the end point would be the same. You have 100 of one symbol, you have 0 entropy.
How come that you have 0 entropy when you have 100% symbol?
Because that 0 times something is 0, and something times 0 is 0. You sum it up, you got 0.
Math. Okay, excuse me, but basically, what does it mean, entropy is 1?
Entropy is 1 means, this number doesn't mean anything really, because if physics, you would not use log 2, you have to multiply it by kT or something like that, so you can get an idea. But in this case, it's just entropy is 1. But it means that it's less, as little determined as possible. It means that you have equal probability finding the book two different letters. Which is as flexible as possible. But the exact number here, the 1, doesn't really mean anything, because you would have to refer to the kT basically, and I guess you should use some log base also. So. And still it would be it wouldn't really mean anything anyway, it's just normalized.
When you say symbol, do you mean the amino
acid? Yes. Yeah, so exactly, something in the text tree, some information. So this, but in our case, would be an amino acid or nucleotide. So this is the tetrasites. So these are 40 tetrasites, sometimes very small set. And it's just, so this is the information. So this A here is the maximum entropy is 2 if you have 4 sites. The same way as the log on plus 1. And you actually invert it, so that's where you take the maximum number minus this, so that's where the A is big.
What's that mean, minus 3, minus 2?
So this is zero is the position of the T and the tata size, this is the sequence alignment. So this is, I guess we define this to be 0, I don't really know why, but that's maybe complex in biology. So basically, that this A is 100% conserved, these two T's are still quite conserved, but there are some cases where you have some other nucleotides here, some A's here, and here, this is the other thing. And if you're here, basically, you have no information at all, basically, all nucleotides are equally likely.
I am missing the part with the beats, so 0, 1, and 2. Corresponds to entropy according to how many positions?
Or 2 minus entropy. Yeah. So it's it's basically this curve but turned upside down. So here you have, on the 4 cycle, you have 2 there, and 0 there, and 2 there. That's why you should plot it as 1 minus entropy. If you want to highlight the conserved positions. So, what this means is that you saw these tata boxes got information, but you can also see that there is, and here there's very little information because base value goes to 0, but here there's some information. So, it means that after the tata box, it's more likely to have a couple extra A's than the other tata. You mean, it's less information, but it's higher than 0. So, it's a very useful way of describing a signal in a multiple signal alignment. And this is just from, I guess, Wikipedia page. So this is a start code of a human mRNAs. and why there are box around it, but I guess it's probably not map. It's probably not a scale, this is A, B. But so what are the nucleotides seeing now after the first entangling? And you see that particular minus 3, but they have a zero, actually, I've got minus 3. There is some information, it's not very high, it's only 0.2, and the maximum could be 2. And minus 1 is information, but there are some, I mean, information there. And then the rest is something that can have a very little. And all the way, here's all the plus 4 is also some information, but then it also drops off quickly. So it's just basically nothing that is used for anything more than visualization. But it's actually, it's a very nice way to visualize this.
Can you please explain the numbers in the X?
This is just a sequence, so I don't know why this is. Yeah, so this is, in this case, it's the first sequence of a protein over an mRNA. It's AUG. And I think this would be higher. I think it's that's very boxed up in the summary, isn't it? But it seems like it should be 100%. And I guess this is the convention also, but the minus one is the position before the Tony Vigna, and so they don't have a zero for some reason. That's convention.
Yeah, I mean, all the different
visualization
strategies can be used for information for predictions, like predicting that if it can be a viable or like. Initiating site for
you can of course use the same information and just calculate how likely, I mean, use it to be in the profile. But so, I mean, sure, if you use the same information in a mathematical model, how likely is it to fit? I mean, it's just sum up probabilities basically. So that would be quite easy to do it. But the log itself is just a visualization. But of course, the information is, as it is more indicated how to do things more lengthy. That, I mean, that's what this. So the easy way is basically what we have here. It basically, So basically, it's to make a profile, to see the profile. And you don't have to have a substitution method, you have to calculate the numbers and say that you have score of, so you have to take a log odds ratio, so you basically take the score of having another minimum position or an little thing, and then go ahead and just add it up together. That's really interesting, but while you look into it, right, to understand it, the visualization is that logs are a very effective way to do it. It's not the only way, but it's something that at least I like. So, but what this lecture mainly is about the machine learning idea. So, when we make these profiles of these patterns, there are a couple of things that are missing from our way of an optimal. One is actually missing negative examples. So we are saying we want to find these examples. We don't care about, in principle, that if we find a lot of other things that shouldn't be there also. We are only very much focused only on finding what is there. And the second type is that we might not have complicated patterns. We cannot see patterns like if position 5 is an allele, position 7 should be a cysteine. So have it more complicated patterns. But what if position 5 is a threonine, maybe position 7 should be a tryptophan, so like more complicated patterns. That is, in a way, a profile, even if the modern model talk about, that cannot be caused in these models. So if there are information like that, we miss it. So machine learning in general is, I mean, now it's got a lot of hype the last couple of years, but it's an old idea from probably early 90s. And the whole idea is basically that you're not going to train a computer to do what you want to do. You don't tell it, you're going to train it. You're going to let the computer learn by itself. So you're not going to say, the classic is image recognition. So you say you want to make a computer recognize all the cats in YouTube. So of course you could try to find a program and decide we want to find something with an arrow like that, just to look at mirror, eyes to this color, whatever. And it will be maybe possible, but it will be very time consuming, quite difficult to set up all these rules. But what you can do in machine learning is that you show the computer a lot of pictures of cats and a lot of pictures of non-cats, maybe dogs or humans or whatever, and you tell the computer to recognize the cat pictures. And that let the computer figure out the best way in itself. And particularly what happened the last few years is what you actually use because it's called deep learning, use very many layers of these networks that you use. And earlier methods really had to type specify, so you have like a special way to recognize straight lines, a special way to recognize contrast and things like that. So you try to teach the computer, make game much more measure. But what's happened with deep learning methods is that seems to, if you don't have enough data, enough computer power, and a bit faster algorithms, can let the computer learn these rules itself. So that is the Japanese the Asian game of Go. I mean, suddenly Google managed to beat the world, or actually not the world champion, but number three in the world, something like that. Which is it's a difference in the way that computers manage to learn to beat the chess championships. Chess is very rule based. You basically follow rules and you just calculate all the possible options for 100 steps forward, which a human mind can't do, then the computer can win. Yes, but in Go, the options are so astronomical, so even the computer can calculate all the options. But so it's much more game based on intuition. So it looks like that. I think I want to put this here. I'm not going to go to Google players, I don't know what people think, but it's much more of an emotional game. You say, this looks like something, I mean, I have some kind of back of mind. And the way that Google trained this computer was to emulate millions and millions of games and then give examples of, like, this is a picture of the board. Okay, is this a good place to put it here or not? And then learn from a lot of examples, and then play against itself also.
What makes Go so complicated compared to regular chess is that when you defeat that piece from the opponent, you can then use that piece against it. So whatever pieces that gets eaten or something, they are seen in the game. You can see use them.
Okay, so that makes expansion much bigger. Yeah. I played Go a long time once or twice in my life, but I don't know, I certainly don't remember exactly how to do it. But from a computation point of view, is really what they did was to show the picture basically, or show right, the layout of the board, and let the computer learn the rules themselves. And in somehow that's very much how a human would learn. You would just play a lot of games, try, and you would play against other people, new people, and you play. And then you learn and learn and learn without really being able to explain what you can do. And that's much more. So that's a typical example, it's an extreme example of machine learning. The ones we do are much simpler. And but it has been just the last few years, really, really breakthroughs. And even if you speak to your Amazon or Siri or Google, telephone and it understands what you're saying. It's all machine learning now. Before it was just the modern world, now it's all the deep learning networks. And it's much better than it was just a few years ago. So in mathematics, machine learning has been used in many, many fields, in most fields. So we talked about a bit about the secondary structure, we talked about protein structure, maybe protein subcell localization. Prediction of genes, there's a lot of different ways to do machine learning, I've used many ways. And, but also for the classification of, like, you have an expression analysis, you want to say, is this from a cancer or non-cancer cell? And you're trying to just take thousands of data points together and try to learn. And you can do it in better or worse ways. And traditionally, it was very much, I think before the deep learning methods come, it was very much to actually put into biology and knowledge there. So key influence, you really, what is the factors that are important to the problem, and I want to present them in as clear way as possible for the computer. But there are a lot of tools for machine learning by mathematics. There are a couple of terms that are important to know, that are, I mean, that's so you know what people talk about. Normally, when you think about things, you talk about classifications, you say, is this good or bad? Is that yes or no? While there are cases where, you, so for instance, in a protein structure, you say, is this a helix or a sheet or a loop? This is binary classifications. It's very much, it's not always the best way to test something, but it's part of the methods are good at doing that, and also it treats our intuition as well. Is this a cat in the picture or not? We don't want to say 0.2 of a gap here. But there are cases when regressions basically figure out that it is 0.2 of a gap there, or this amino acid is 50% exposed to the water, not 90%. And in most cases, you can use very, very similar techniques to that also. You have to have a tune them that differently. But there is a clear terminology difference in regression and classification. I will mainly talk about supervised learning today, but there are cases of people with unsupervised learning, and that's in particular when you don't really know how the data should be classified. You're trying to make it more for finding patterns that you're not really thinking about the problem. It's more like a way of getting thinking about the problem than really to use it for a prediction or something else. In some cases, also, you see supervised learning not that common, but there are people doing that. Where you basically have some of the data you know and some of you don't know. A method to get common is to actually only know the positive step, but you don't know the net negative step, but you assume that it's mainly negative. So, what is the one to do? So, this is a typical example. So, two variables here. You have and two sets of patients. You have patients that will get heart cardiac disease in patients that will not get heart cardiac disease. And this is normally you've got two dimensions, you have 200 dimensions of that, but for simplicity it's 62 dimensions. And there are two measures, I guess it's the low density lipoprotein and the high density lipoprotein. So you have two measures together, they have two numbers from something else. And you can see just by looking at data, if you're high on LDL and low on HDL, that's probably the bad, because you have a higher risk of getting cardiac disease. And what is the best way of separating? You have a line like that, or a line like that, whatever. What is the best way to separate this? Or you might actually have really the LDL and HDL, maybe you have two expressions of two genes instead of just doing some cell culture or something like that. So the expression level of mRNA1 and mRNA2. And particularly what you want to answer is what is the risk for this person here with these numbers to get cardiac disease? That might somewhat depend on how we do classification here. Do you think it's adaptive, like that, is it higher risk? And you want to be as good as possible to estimate this risk, because when you say if you have a high risk, you tell them to stop eating fat while running, and if you have a low risk, then keep on having fun. Or maybe it's fun to run, I think so, but maybe that person doesn't like it. So if you define a line like that, so basically in machine learning, what you want to do is to find the best possible separation. And assuming you have a straight line, maybe this is the best one, then that patient would be quite safe.
And the result, the output is a yes or no question, a probability or...
So that depends. If you use a classification, you have a yes or no. You can have some reliability, how likely you say yes or no, but you would say that it's... it's a very certain prediction, not very convincing prediction, because you have some probability that your prediction is correct. But if it was a regression, you may be able to have saying that this is like 10% or 90% chance of getting disease.
But for that example, could the classification be in a logistic regression form?
And this you can use really easily, yeah. This will be a classification, yeah. Because the input data or the data has will be yes or no here. We don't have know that the ones that got fit, we don't have a group of people 50% cardiac disease. It's just yes or no.
But could it return as a probability that it could have the heart disease or not?
Sure, you could, you could have it. You can even say that you could have distinguished it into several layers. The closer you are here, you have higher risk. But, yeah. So you can have, what you can do is basically your post-process genetics and say, this one has this course. And normally you get an altitude of 0 and 1, and 0 is far up here and 1 is far down there. And this will maybe be 0.7, and then you have your database. If you have 0.7, you have 22% risk to be get disease. So that's, but if you really would have to say yes or no, you would guess on no in this case. Right, in unsurprising, you may end up with health under this. You don't know what it looks like, but you would like to classify it together, and you will get, hopefully, something like this. And you say, then I have studied this group here, this group together, so what can I learn from these groups? Maybe I can say that if you're in this group, you have 80% risk, and this one, you have 10% risk, you have cardiac disease. So I can just basically clustering on the data without knowing the answer ahead of time. But I do many dimensions, so I will do the best possible clustering. So, was that the best way to maybe I think we have to work the machine set? Let's look at this first. So one type of this machine learning matrix that was popular this until 2 years ago was this support-based machines. It's quite easy to understand. It's basically you want to find a vector, so a line or a that separates the two data points. And when we want to find one that separates it, that's possible. And now you have to think that you have hundreds of dimensions. So it's a hyperplane, it's not just a line. But so you find for the decision structure, you want to find this method. And now basically what supervised machines do is that they actually find best possible surface. And you can actually find one. So actually all of these surfaces, all these lines are perfectly separating these two points. But you take only one that actually has the most marginal between them. And in some cases, of course, you can allow some other problems. You can allow some allow some errors, etc. However, this is not another problem, it's a big problem. So this is your expression on the gene of the average, yes? And all your red dots are here and all your green dots are here. How can you separate them? It's only one dimension. So what you can do? That can, for instance, take a square of the expression. And plot that against the expression level. So the expression and expression. So I basically change the dimensions of my data. I add one more dimension. And then it's very easy to separate the dimensions like that. So by adding more dimensions to the data, I will have much easier to find a plane that separates them perfectly. The problem is that I can add it in many ways, and sometimes it doesn't work. But sometimes you still don't really do it. But this is what's using a so-called kernel function. Basically, I take my data here, I apply my mathematical function to it that adds it up to more dimensions, and then I try to find this plane that separates my two separate dots. So another way of setting it, seeing it, is another example here. So here you imagine as a linear kernel with a straight line. It's a bit, but not extremely well. There's something very close to it. I could use a polynomial kernel, so I get something that basically takes another dimension. If you get lines, we can find this part of it in that part. It will be very difficult to get an output for something lying here. In the first case, it will be a very clear blue dot. In this other case, it will be a very clear red dot. So, and I don't have an example, so I don't know what's correct, but if I have other red things here, I would know that this is this separation is better. I can also use called regular basis function for us, we have seen them separate from that. So basically the idea is to go from like some kind of info space to some other higher dimension space and make them easy to separate the dots from each other. And you can basically add an infinite amount of dimensions. And there are some limitations to how this current looks like, so you can't bring it from infinite amount of information. So that's one way to do it. The other way is to do it is this so-called machine learning and neural networks that are was probably the first machine learning method that was introduced. One of the first of these. And it's actually now these learning methods is becoming standard again. Those are kind of out of fashion for a while and now it's back. So the idea comes from, of course, trying to mimic the a neuron in our brain or in an animal. And how does the nerve work?
Well, I guess I have a shot. This one doesn't seem too happy. So I'll try to speak loud instead. So a nerve has kind of body and synapse. We're a body that has input with our synapses. They get input from other nerves. They have an axon, and then have, at the end it's connected to other nerves. So they basically, what it does is that it integrates the input from other nerves and then decides if you should fire an output again. It's a bit more complicated than that. Generally, there are time signals and time lapses, etc. But from a computational point of view, it's not a bad approximation. So in the network, you can do the same thing. You can basically have an input node there that is connected to other nodes in some way, and it does some kind of mathematics here and decides that if this mathematics here, if the sum here is higher than cutoff, or if it follows a function, I send out another signal. So, if you do that, what you need to do when you're training is to adjust these weights. So when you're learning, you're trying to change the weights so that you get better at recognizing your cats, whatever you want to find in your networks. So normally, when we talk about networks, here at least we talk about feed-forward networks. They don't have to look it up, but that's what we deal with here. So if you have an input layer, you have one or several hidden layer, and you have an output layer. And all the signal goes in one direction. There are other types of networks also, so the methods that we use, that are using in Go, etc., are much more complicated, but that's in biology, at least what we talk about today, would be mainly these networks. So basically, you can have a simple function that is just if the output is higher than cutoff, we give it 1, or if we give it output to 0,
or you can have some slightly smoother function which has some advantages because it's not so binary stuff. It's more like, you know, it's similar to the answer, gives smoother output.
So this was a problem in XOR. So you know from logic what XOR means?
So what is XOR? Me and my wife, wants to go to the cinema. Then if I want to go and she wants to go, we don't go. But if none of us wants to go, we don't go. But if one of us wants to go, we go to the cinema. So we have to annoy the other one, I guess. So that's the... So basically, if you have 0, 0, you get 0 output. If you have 1, 1, you get 0 output. But it's 1 or 0, and 0, 1, you get 1 output. So of course, there's no linear function you can use to separate the black dots from the white dots. It doesn't exist, because it doesn't exist as linear separator. I could use this SVM and add one dimension, and take the squares of this or something like that, to multiply this with one of these with some number, and I could find a linear function maybe. But for this narrow network, I can actually do it also. So, but I cannot use a proof. I can use a proof that adds things up to separate these two dots.
There's a question, like, for example, in biology or in biomedicine, if we have biomarkers, if that data like that is usually linear in nature.
Yeah.
Like, so would it be better to use multivariate linear regression or neural?
In many cases, you could probably manage quite well with linear cases, but there are certainly, we have cases where you see a better performance using neural networks, yes, it's quite clear. So, in the secondary structure problem, I don't think, we talk about, I guess, tomorrow, or Friday, Thursday, I think, I think it's not a huge difference, but it's a clear separation in performance difference. So you really have signals. I don't know exactly what the signals are, because it's hard to interpret, but there clearly are signals that are like, kind of, if this one is here, this one should be here. So that's, and that you don't see in the linear, if you use a multi-variable linear function. But it's mostly in the small, in the last performance, but that's kind of important also, but it's many things can probably be linear. But basically, it's, but I think it's needed, and particularly for the more complicated problems. On the other hand, the methods for these are quite easy to use. So sometimes it's as easy to use, you can use PCA just to separate things and do something like that. But machine learning training, if you don't know what you're doing, it's actually not a bad idea because it's just plug it in the box and run. And it actually gets good performance of that. So actually, if you generate this network, it's a bit complicated here, but this is the weight, this is the input, this is the cutoffs, and this is the cutoffs, or the number you take away. So if you have to do the calculation here, so if we have cutoffs, if we have inputs, the inputs are input x1 and x2, I guess. So the inputs are 0, 0, or 0, 1, or 1. 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. And then you have the hidden layers. You have the hidden layer, that's what hidden 1 and hidden 2. So the input is just the sum of the numbers. They have the weights are 1 in most cases. So these weights here are all 1. So it's just the sum. So input hidden 1 is 1. So that means that the input here is 0, 1, 1, and 2. And here we have a cutoff of minus 1.5, and here we have a cutoff of minus 4. You subtract 1.5, so the cutoff is 1.5. Basically, and the cutoff is always 0. So if you take away 1.5 here, so 0 here, minus 1.5, minus 0.5, minus 0.5, and plus 0.5. So this is the only one that's higher here. So the only one that will give 1 the next one. This one has a minus 0.5 here. So there we have minus 0.5, plus 0.5, plus 0.5, and plus 1.5. So all these will give have an output output from these hidden layers. And then we have a weight here, so let's call it the output layer here. I said output, just output. And then you have this number here, which you multiply by minus 2, and this one by 1.0. So minus 2 times minus 1.5 is, minus 2 times 0 is 0, plus, this is also 0. So these are ones that are 0, plus 0. Here I have 0 plus 1 times 1, so I have 1. And here is the same. And here I have actually minus 2 plus 1. So basically, this one is minus 1, this one is plus 1, this one is plus 1, this is 0. And I have, take away 0.5 here, to subtract minus 0.5, that means that this one is actually minus 0.5, this is plus 0.5, plus 0.5, and minus 1.5. It means that these ones are the only ones that give an output from this one known here. This means that the output here will be 1, 1, here will be 0, and 0. It's exactly the XOR function I want to have.
You don't get the output function.
The output here, basically I take away, I subtract whatever I have here, I subtract that, the number, the sum I have here. The sum I have here, I subtract 0.5 from that one.
Yes, but for example, 0 plus 0 and 0 plus 1, where did the 1 and 0 come from?
The 0 plus the 1 comes from, because this one here, so output on this H2 here is 1 if it's higher than 0, and it's 0 if it's less than 0. So here's the output of 0, 1, 1, 1. This one has the output of 0, 0, 0, 1.
So how come that the last one got minus 2?
Because I multiply by this weight that is over here. So I take this output, multiply it with the weight, minus 2. So they get 1 times minus 2 plus 1 times 1. And
shouldn't everyone get minus 2?
What?
Shouldn't all of them get minus 2?
No, because these are 0. 0 times minus 2 is 0.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's then I end up with this. It's a very artificial example, and this is nothing, it's just a way to set. They just assure you that you can get a method like that to learn more complicated patterns than just adding things up together. So, of course, in a real network, you have hundreds of examples, inputs of thousands, and hundreds in layers and deep layers. Not hundreds of layers, you have hundreds of thousands of weights. So what you do in machine learning is that you should give it examples. So you construct a network of that with many layers, and you have weights to maybe put randomly to start with, and then you train your network to adjust the weights so you get the output you want. So you give it examples of positive examples and negative examples. And then you train it and then you give it an example, and you realize, okay, it's wrong in half the cases. I change the weight slightly, and it gets slightly better, and I keep changing the weights. So I can have basically optimized the weights. So this is the training. And we have post, so you can have, yeah. So you normally start with some random weights and you show one example, you calculate the error, you change the weight somehow, you use what's called back propagation, and you repeat it, and you do this. You do this hundreds of thousands of times. So it takes some time. And that's why you need a lot of training examples. So then I was going to show you target P. It was just well, I think we stop there.
Could we have a short break for a minute or so?
Sure. So I was going to just tell you about some final comments before I talk about this target P. And what concept of the body is actually overfitting. So this is, in principle, if you take a supported machine and neural network, you just add enough dimensions, add enough nodes. You can teach it anything. And the problem is that you don't really want it to be perfect at classifying your data. You want it to be perfect at actually predicting unseen data. So this is a simple example. You have blue and red dots. And you have two machines. One is the black machine and one is the green machine that is used for classifying. You see the green machine is much better. It's perfect. But would you think that this green line is really good, because it's really, if you have a new dot here, well, it's actually more like if you have a new dot here or here, do you think that should be red or blue? And most likely it would be blue if it was here or here, or red if it was there. It's just a bit noise in the data, probably. Because, so basically, what this green machine has done is to be perfect at classifying everything else, but it lost it. Ability to generalize, to really tell things good for the future. And this is a real problem, because you can easily train a neural network to recognize everything perfectly, but it doesn't mean that it's very good at recognizing unseen data.
Can I have a question?
Yes.
But we only have, for example, one red dot in all the blue, in the middle, let's say. If there were five of them there,
maybe the green line is better, yes.
Like,
or maybe something else should be better. And the trick to do that, what you do is that you have a different set of training data and test data. So you train one set of data and you test another set of data.
Whatever is close to the line, though, it cannot really predict, right? Because it might be a matter of chance.
It depends on if your data is maybe it's extremely big number separating. I don't know, it all depends, but yeah. Sure, so it always going to be some borderline cases. And most data has some noise in it. But we don't know how much this noise is. It depends on the measurements and the data, whatever. And but the whole idea is that what you want to do is you want to use divide data into test sets and training sets. So you can have one test set and one training set, or another way to do it is to have cross-validation, which is a common way to do it, because you can actually use all the data, but you actually train it maybe three times. You divide your data into three sets, and you use two sets to train it and test the third. You do that three times, you can use all this data. But you have, of course, to run the training three times.
For one time, you do learner one, two, and three.
No, one time you learn learner one, and then you learn learner two, next time you learn three, and then for final set you maybe take the average of all three or something. And you can do different tricks. Or you learn what was the best way to do it and use all the data from that. It varies. But the whole idea is that you actually evaluate the performance of another set and test the same one. Because this way, if it was really so that the green line was better, so you always have to do things like that, you will learn it. It was always the case that the background was there, that it was out of noise, you learn that also. So the idea is often something like this. Basically, if you have a training set and test, this is a neural network. And in the beginning, so this is an error function you have. So how many errors do you do? So how good are you? And in the beginning, you go down very fast. But then you keep on running, and the performance on the training set gets better and better and better. It's really fine, not to zero, but two to zero. Well, actually, the test set stops here somewhere. So there seems to be no reason to do more than 100 runs or iterations.
So were you saying as soon as like the training set go below the test set and the test set?
No, well, not maybe, but as soon as the test set, see, it actually goes up here, it gets worse, you get worse performance. So you maybe want to take the minimum test set somewhere like that.
Can the test set never be as good as the training set? I mean, if
it were big enough, it should be. Probably if you have enough examples, you probably do it. I mean, basically, yes. It also depends on, like, what you want to do is to make sure that the test sets and training sets are representative, so they really contain equal types of data points. So you want to, in sequence, what we do is that we actually, so you want to contain all possible classes. For instance, say that you want to have the two groups of proteins that they're both can be classified together. You want to make sure that both are present both in tests and training sets. On the other hand, you don't only want to have sequence signals that are not relevant. So you often take away things that are homologous. You want to find things that are only the ones that have a signal, really, not the ones that have to learn to recognize these family of proteins, for instance. So there are many cases where you figure what you do is you basically want to take away everything that is too similar. And you want to have a general set of things as much as possible. So there is a classical example, I think it was from the American Army, where you have, they were training something to recognize tanks on pictures. So they were basically, took photographs of tanks that want to invade the US. I don't know why we're invading the US, but let's say, are the tanks there or not? So they trained. And you get a perfect prediction, it was very good recognizing the only prediction rate. And then they went out another day, take new pictures, and nothing worked. And then they realized that all the pictures that were taken where they had tanks was on a cloudy day, all the pictures were not having tanks were also on a sunny day. So you were very good at recognizing sunny and cloudy days. So you have to have, there's an example where the data was not representative, not equally distributed, so you really had different types of data. And maybe you have, if you have cats in the video, maybe you have the music and background matters, whatever. Or but that's good to be. So basically, we do sequence analysis. So one way actually we need to do is to say, how do we code the sequence? So we want a number input. And sequences and meiosis are friendly. And it's not a good idea to call them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 to 20. So what we do here is basically take the number times the weight. And then it means that we have whatever number 20 was, we have to define is 20 times stronger than early. And that is not really the way you want to have it. So the most common way to do this was called sparse encoding. It means that you actually have 20 inputs for each position in the sequence. And F0 and 1 depends on if that rescue is present or not. So that means that you will have a lot of inputs. So even for 5 residue, a 5 residue sequence, you will have 100 inputs. There are some alternative ways you can do it. You can classify into groups of sequences or amino acids or into a physical chemical parameters, so that makes sense. But in principle, this is normally quite a good way to do it. So that means that if you have a sequence, the MASL is represented by these strings of zeros and ones. But as I said, there are other ways to do it also, but they are less frequently used, I think. Another problem is like that many signals are not exactly equal long. So we have like if we want to predict what is a helix, they can be different lengths. So what is a meter sheet, they can be different lengths. And of course, the neural networks somehow have a fixed window. They're not very good at dealing with different lengths. There are probably ways you can get around it, but in particular, that's what we use in the market models under that, but that's not. But the normal technique is a sliding window technique. So that means that you look at the piece of the sequence at the time. So let's say if you have a window of 7, the first window is these 7 residues, and you predict the feature of the fourth residue, the L. Second window is the next one, the next residue 2 to 8, and you predict the features of residue B. So I may ask, so if it is, is this a helix, is this a helix, is this a helix, is this a helix? And if it's yes or no, then you have a trainer to try to predict it. But it's not obvious that, of course, there are many things that are not so well represented like that. If you are predicting only one cleavage size, it's going to be 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. Or a tautomorph, it's going to be 0 everywhere else, things like that. But it's often we don't have a better way to represent it. So it's a common way to do it. Sometimes we can combine different things together. So that's a common trick. Yes.
So the windows, it's size of 7, they move one point at a time.
Yes.
And they just take into account the middle?
Yes.
Did you saddle up to take into account like the middle? Do you saddle up to like, do you read the number 4 in years ago? Like, is there an
I set it up to, to evaluate position number 4. I'm not sure I got what you meant to.
Yeah, so you set it up to only evaluate
Yes.
Number 4.
Yeah, yeah. So often, the ends, I often do some special tricks with them. I either ignore them or I do something else with them. But, I mean, depending, hopefully not so many.
But I thought, like, if you want to determine is it finish or alpha helix, don't you need to look at not just one?
Well, you look at it actually, but the window looks at more residues, but you do it one residue by one residue at a time.
Okay.
So you actually, you look at a bigger window, but you want to determine, so basically, the next window you look at could be, have another secondary structural element. Because it determines the labeling is residue by residue. But I always look at the bigger window, so 7 is of those maybe 15 or something, or 19 even. So you could to determine the central residue. And then I shift one step further away and look at the next residue. But I'm still a window of the week.
So does it matter how big is your window? Because you always only go for one.
Basically, yes, it matters. Because so basically, well, there's one parameter you try different options for. And normally, if you have a bigger window, because you have more information. But if you have a smaller window, you have, but you also add noise, because there's no signal. I mean, it's very signal 50 residues away from where you are. So often, in the order of 10 to 20 is normal, what is best. But this is just a try and see whatever works best. It depends on the problem. But after a while, basically, there's no influence. I mean, if it matters, then you should keep it, but if you're far away, it won't have any influence. So the problem here was discussed with target P. So target P was basically something that Olof developed, that is predicting if a cell, if a protein is in the ER, mitochondria, chloroplast, or somewhere else. So do you know anything about subcellular targeting? So basically, after translation, it's decided where the protein ends up. And these three pathways here, through the secretory, mitochondria, chloroplasts, have rather similar sequence, signal peptides called, or N-terminal pre-sequences. So the N-terminal part of these sequences has a signal that is recognized by other proteins, and then they are sorted into these three groups. So the problem is to recognize these three signals, and or the lack of these three signals ending up in the other group. But these signals are similar, but they're not the same. So actually, I guess this is the sort of patterns so that are known there, but so they are the signal patterns for the ER is about 25 minutes long. Has a cleavage size that has an IVXAC, I guess. But the contour pattern is a bit longer and has a not a completely different cleavage pattern, which is dominated by some arginines. And a chloroplast transfer is even longer and has another third cleavage size. So if you do the sequence logos for this, you will end up seeing this. So this is a single factor. So you have an alanine here and alanine here. And you just have a lot of hydrophobic amino acids there, you see. Leucine, valine, alanine. And you see that by the maximum here is about 4 bits. So this is quite a lot of information, much more than anywhere else. The other ones you see have much less strong signals. They have something that have this is R-2, R-3, R-10 here. So you have some arginines there. And there's something of alanine and serine directly after. And this has two alanines around here and a valine and maybe an arginine here, etc. So there are, and but these signals are much weaker than that one. And this information here is also much higher than this, because this is 1 bit and this is half a bit. But there's some information at least in all this. This is something in machine learning mathematics can learn. So how do you train it? So you use the tricks themselves. First, you need to extract your data. So you go to your favorite database at SwissProt. Because SwissProt, as you know, was manually annotated and quite reliable. If you would have used UniProt, you would have most likely just found other things that some other methods have predicted. So you would not use the way to train a predictor to train the same thing as something else. But here, I think there should be some sort of manual things. However, SwissProt is not perfect, so actually we have spent a lot of time reading literature, so basically look at all the references and read paper by paper. And look at, do we really trust this data or not? And I think like 94% of the cases, it kept it in the 5% of the literature or something like that. And then you remove sequences that are similar. So basically you have the same sequence twice, sequences are very similar. You remove them, so you use what's called homology reduction. And well, at this point, you actually do it like this. You look here, there is a feature signal here that says transit peptide 1 to 55 chloroplast. So you can write a computer program that finds this signal here and extracts all the sequences. And in this whole reduction, you basically align everything in there. You should spin what one we learned about. You compare distribution scores and you have well, you get thematic cutoffs. So here you, I think, was one question. Here I can use the whole sequence of everything. But if it's just similar in a single pattern, you probably not be significant. So you will see it. But it's not a very strongly conserved signal, most likely. But if it was, you would be it. You define some cutoff and you take away every. If you have two proofs now more similar than a cutoff. This was not using e-values, that's what I would use today, but that was not what they used. And take away the one with the highest number of neighbors, and you keep on doing it until you have as many pairs. I mean, end up with no pairs, more similar than cutoff, and you end up with homology-reduced data sets. So this is a data set. For plants, to start with about 500 amino acids, 500 proteins in each class. And after homology reduction, you had a few hundred. In a non-plant set, that's done with chloroplast, you have maybe a few thousand sequences in each class, and you end up with about 1,000 or slightly less in each of the three groups. And then you basically want to develop three different predictors, one for chloroplast, one for mitochondria, one for single peptides, and you integrate them into a joint predictor, and you have some cutoff that basically tells you what we should believe. And you also have some error function, and also reliability count, which is basically just the difference between the highest and the second highest cutoff there, or value without. So this is an example of the predictor does,
output. So you have a sliding window here that predicts one number for each residue for the first 120 residues. And the core blast is, in this case, is high all the way up here until you have 50, and then goes low. This one is low until you go up something like that, and then it goes here. And this one is also somewhere similar. So in this case, I would imagine just by looking at this output, it would be quite clear. This is probably how a core blast prediction should look like, because it has high numbers for this one and low for others, but a bit of noise. And then you take this output, all these 120 times three numbers, and put this into an integrated network, and get a prediction like this. So in one case here, P11043, you have 87.3 probability to be forecast, 1.2%, something about mitochondria, 0.4 single peptide, and 0.32 would be other. So you predict the core blast, and you have a reliability of 3 here, because the difference between these is not too big. Next one, you have even higher probability to be core blast, and you have core blast, and the reliability is higher. This one is actually quite close core between the core blast and mitochondria, they're almost the same, but the mitochondria is slightly higher, so you take this one, and but the reliability goes down, or goes up, because.
What was the 5?
So this is sum up basically the difference in score of the two top ones. But I don't know why they have. Most other methods use a high number when it's good and low number when it's bad, but this used the other way around, in a way. Yes?
Why do they not add up to 1?
Why doesn't it add up to 1? This is just because they're basically got 4 different networks, and you could normalize them and add up to 1, but this is just outputs of it. It's nothing. It's how the weights put the numbers together, and this train will be 1, 0, 0, but it doesn't mean that they always have really some of 1. Because the trigger is 1, 0, 0, and then basically have four different outputs. And normally, of course, it should be close to 1, and the other output not perfect. Yeah.
Right, you could normalize them if you want to.
Sorry, did you say like the 3, 1, 5, 3 is the.
It's basically, if it's a low number, basically it's the difference between that number, the highest number, and the second highest number, yes. So how much should you trust the prediction? And for some reason, normally you have it's 9 if it's good, but in this case they haven't done it around. I don't know why. But so basically, if it's 1, it's a big difference. So here is a big difference, and here is a small difference. Stable. So you can say, this I really trust. This I'm more doubtful about. Mm-hmm. And this here is also quite trustful, but it's pretty busy. Nothing else. A few details with the training, they used, when they developed it, they tried a lot of different parameters. They didn't only try it once. They tried a window size between 7 and 55. 55 seems very big to me, but that's what it is. Standard between 200 and 1,000 training rounds. And different number of hidden layers. Hidden nodes. Also different learners, but how fast you should learn things. So probably tried at least 100 different combinations and took the one that in the training set, and one that performed best in the test set. And no really good rule what is the best way to do it, you just try. So that's maybe some experience helps, but in principle, it's just try best combinations. Basically, it's the performance, but it's not processing. It's shifted. But basically, you can see here, I have this number called MCC, which is matrix correlation coefficient. You see that we do better on synapeptides than we do on the other ones. That's easier for the synapeptides than there are with the other ones. And that was related that the signal was clearer there. We have 90% correct there, and the other one was 75% correct. And if you remember, in logos, there was a much clearer signal than synapeptides, so it kind of makes sense. And you can also see here, which is difficult to shift it, that there are, particularly in mitochondria, core blast, there are more confusions than there are between others. And that's also because the synapeptides are more similar. If you look at the logos, they were, and the synapeptide was more different. So these patterns here are rather similar. And they also have some alanines here and arginines there. It's a bit more similar, not perfectly the same, but more similar.
I guess that was basically it for the going through the lectures. So I don't know if there are any questions I missed. Target people down. If the pre-seek is an example subset of saying, could you please provide some more details regarding the weak consensus? That was a logos basically. I can't think more about that. Consequence of overtrain. So basically what happened in Orfit, you could certainly in this target P case, you could do perfectly on the train set. You can learn it perfect, but you will get less good performance on the unseen. So you will not be, you will be worse on the test set. And that's how do you choose the current path? It's not needed, it's not really a good way. You try. The two parameters is just a try, and I'm trying to change it. Example for unsupervised learning. People use it quite a lot in microarrays, and my expression analysis, you basically try to classify cells together or patients together, but you don't know how they should be classified, so maybe that's at least one case I know people are using it, probably others also that I don't know about. Where's the output of the given example? Yes, no answer. So yeah, normally you have a yes or no, or one or two, or one or three groups, something like that. So basically, when you have this chloroplast, what you call the target peptide, you actually have three outputs. Yeah, yes, no for chloroplast, yes, no for mitochondria, yes, no for four outputs for chloroplast, and yes, no for other. And the yes, no is between 0 and 1. So 1 is yes, and the output is a number, but you can put 0.5, you could put a cutoff and call it yes or no. So the output is normally a number, actually. The confidence interval is often just, it's not really something that's built in there. It's more of a post-processing way. So often you take it, you can take your data, you can divide into the ones that are likely to be, the ones that have a big difference. I mean, you can take the ones, if you have output between 0 and 1, you can take the ones that are 0, 9 and up and see how many corrects to have here. And normally it correlates quite well with the high scoring ones are more correct. But it's not a perfect, it's not like it's 90% or 50% or 10%, it's not perfect. So you have to just test on your training set, on your test set and see how you did, and then you adjust the function to that. So target P, we move the whole sequence. Sliding window, I think we explained. Was that it? Overfitting, when do you stop? Basically, you stop when you do not, when the performance is getting worse on the test set, which is not always easy to see, but that's the idea at least.
But then you know how you say when you do that, you do the cross validation, so you're using basically you have. So like three data sets and then two training sets and one test set. So when you talk about your graph like this, mm-hmm. So how does that relate to the three, like for example?
So that means that you basically, if you look at this graph here, you do, So basically what you do is you say, maybe here, 150, it starts going down. So then you decide, I always do 150, and I keep on doing that. And you keep that output. So it's a bit of like, I mean, cheating because you optimize somehow on the test set, but that's normally where it's done. You can then test it again in a completely independent set if you want to.
For the epoch, for each repetition, do we have to do it manually or can we have a program that
does it? Of course, the program does it. Yeah, so anything the computer can do, you can let the program to do it. So that so even if you all the parameters you have tried, you just iterate through. I mean, sometimes it's not possible to do all combinations, but you can then have some smart algorithm to do it. That is So but basically, you often what you do is that you train and you test here. Okay, on my test center, I get best if I run 100 epochs. So that's, then I decide I don't run it, I keep on doing that. But I always test the performance. If you say, when it's, for instance, what is the best window size? What do you 7 or 9 or 11 or 13 or 15? I do that, and I maybe do the same number of epochs, but I try. But I don't evaluate the performance on my trains that I evaluate on the test set. On the test set. So every parameter that I optimize, I see whatever gets best performance on the test set, but not what gets best performance on the train set. For a train set, basically, the more big your window, probably the better, because I have more data, I can learn more things, but that doesn't necessarily provide better performance on the test set. So basically, the more parameters I have, it's easier to learn it on the training set, but I'm also less good at generalizing. Okay?
Please explain the Shannon plot. I think we did that in the extra problem. This will work, okay? And I think that's more or less it. Are we done? Mm-hmm. Stop recording.